Thank you for joining us for Coloring Outside the Lines. I'm so excited and thrilled for this next panel of incredible femmes and women, especially Black women, who are talking about this work in humanism. As you know, this movement is often led and has often been known to be led from a very patriarchal lens, particularly a white lens. And here we are pushing the dialogue a little bit further, engaging with panelists such as Mandisa Thomas, Olivia Busby, and storäe Michele, and moderated by Lewis-Cornwell. And so I'm just so grateful to have this moment. And I can tell you, Nicole is gonna probably have us think deeply about our own relationship as we enter into this conversation of coloring outside the lines and hospitality and humanism.
I'm really looking forward to the panel, and I want to make sure everybody knows that the panelists will be taking some questions at the end. So make sure to type anything you want to ask in the Q&A tab, which is next to the chat tab. And Jay and I will be back for the last part of the session to read them, so you can have some sort of conversation with the panelists.
But before we get a little started, this particular panel has to start off with a grounding moment, which is always important, because Black women, as we know, and as we've often read in some theories, that they are curators of culture. And so I offer you this grounding meditation by storäe Michele, one of the panelists on this meditation.
I was looking at the ceiling, and then I saw the sky. June Jordan, a Black bisexual playwright, poet, and essayist, found this phrase in the LA Times from an earthquake survivor. I reflect on my own ceilings, challenges, struggles at the intersections. How many restrictions live in my body? What are the ones I cannot hide? When I look up, what do I see? How many freedoms till I'm free? This makes me anxious. Water, primordial, alive, pools, splashes, reminders, growth, abundance, persistence. Listen. 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 To the plants, the furry friends, the creepy crawlies, the winged creatures. They understand. They know survival. They know expansion. They know the sky is always there to greet you.
That's powerful. Thank you so much for sharing that. So we'll do quick introductions first. I am Leika Lewis-Cornwell. I use they and she pronouns. And I am coming to you from my home in Delaware on occupied Black Lenape tribal land. And I will be moderating this panel today. We'll pass it on to Mandisa.
Thank you very much, Leika, and thank you to Nicole and Jay, my fellow panelists, storäe and Olivia. My name is Mandisa Thomas. For those of you who aren't familiar with me, I am the founder and president of Black Nonbelievers Incorporated, which is headquartered in the Atlanta, Georgia area. I come to you specifically from Fayetteville, Georgia. I am a native of New York City, Jamaica, Queens to be exact. But I am on land that was indigenous to the Kawita Creek people in Georgia. I am also a board member for the American Humanist Association, as well as American atheists. And I am very, very honored to be here with you this morning.
Thank you, Mandisa. Storäe.
Hello, beautiful people. I am so excited to be here with you all and to be in good company with Leika, Mandisa, and Olivia. I am a Afrofuturist, trippy ritualist, and a storyteller. I am coming to you from the unceded territory of the Nakashtonk people, a land in which I also experienced my childhood, and I use they, them pronouns.
Thank you, Storäe. And Olivia.
Good morning, everyone. I'm really glad to be here with all of you, especially with Leika, Mandisa, and Storäe. I use she or they pronouns. I'm a poet, a writer, and a creative doula. And I am currently in Cincinnati, Ohio, which is occupied Kaskaskia, Osage, Shawandasi Tula, and Miamia territory. So they wiped out a lot to be here. So good morning and thanks for having me.
Wonderful. So just a question to start us out for all of y'all. And that is what, and Olivia, be coming to you first, and then Storäe, and then Mandisa, y'all can jump in as you're ready. What does for you an expansive, inclusive, expressive humanism look like? What is your vision, and what are the ways in which the work that you do in yourself and in your community, how does that contribute to that vision?
For me, I have been basing my humanism in my experience in theology school in the idea of stories, and that regards to especially ancestral stories. And so the practice to me of looking at ancestral stories is communing with the body, because that connects us to our ancestors. It's communing with our home, which is the earth, because that is where our body is centered and grounded. And it's also a practice of, through my readings of like Alexis Pauline Gums, expanding ancestors to like the earth, and like Storäe said, the creepy crawlies and the furry creatures and all of the like creatures and life forces that make us. And I think for me, through doing that, it's situated me, especially being on this land that I'm in. I'm in Cincinnati, which is right the border where freedom became for, you know, freedom, of course, became for Black people. And so it's kind of also allowed me to see like the kind of like ghost that's all around us. And so as I like situate into my body and the stories of my ancestors, I am able to kind of ground and center myself in the story of like why I'm here, of the story of my seeing like different relationships that I have with other people, and why these certain things that are said or these interactions that I have with people can kind of ping the body in certain ways, because it is all situated in the body, and so the body kind of holds the memory of who you are and where you're from. And I think that's kind of been for me where my humanism has brought me to my body. And I think through other avenues, I find that if more people, especially, you know, white people, were to situate themselves in their ancestry and the ancestral stories that we have, it wouldn't necessarily, I don't think we can reach back into the past to find the capital T truth, but it would definitely begin like conversations of just self-exploration and understanding like what ghost and what's being stored in our own bodies that we can explore that connect us to another time that, and connected to another time that is happening right now, as time is not linear. It's happening as I'm in Cincinnati. I'm literally feeling like the ghost of all of the chaos that probably was happening if you had the river right there and this like liminal, like this space of like moving into freedom. I literally feel like the chaos that probably was happening. And I see it, the results of it, and the like interactions with that ghost in the space. And so I think that's where my kind of humanism lies, because we are all connected to it all. Like, so
yeah. Ashe, I just want to jump in. That was beautiful. Thank you for that, Olivia. You touched on so many things that resonate with me and how I came to humanism. I do a lot of work, as you saw the meditation, I do a lot of work around speculative fiction, which is why we saw the dualities throughout the film piece. I also believe we have multiple stories that live inside of us that are surrounding us. And there aren't really words that can explain all of the things that we are experiencing, all the things that we are feeling. And we experiment a lot in order to survive all of those stories daily, especially as Black femmes and women. I believe that, you know, our lives are in fact speculative, in that we aren't meant to survive in them, but somehow we're still here. And somehow we have stories and evidence that prove that we belong to be here. My humanism is situated there in the fact that many, many generations before me have lived and survived and created stories and created rituals of survival. I believe that humanism is so ripe for that type of experimentation as well, and that we're not going to get it right all the time. We see that happening where we have a reprise of so many things that we thought were set in stone that we're seeing being turned over. Literally, to be alive in this time is speculative. It is science fiction. And I believe humanism is an avenue in which I can create different ways and different modes of communing, of being alive, of seeing other people, of listening to not just humans, but to nature. We are a part of nature, to decenter who humans are and understand that everything around us teaches us something daily, and to pay attention to that, and to know that we are here to grow from each other's experiences. So I think that listening and seeing is a big part of how I access my humanism.
All right, and I guess I will conclude this portion of the question. I really appreciated hearing both Olivia and Storäe's words on how what defines their humanism. And so I will add to that by saying that for me, and being especially in this community, in this movement now for 11 years within the atheist, humanist, secular community, my humanism comes from a multitude of factors. First and foremost, being immersed in Blackness, being immersed in our history, being immersed in our culture, being immersed and educated in the fact that our Blackness does not simply begin with being enslaved in this country. I was fortunate enough to have had that that information taught to me when I was young, as being born and raised in New York, learning that there was more to Blackness than just the negative connotations. And that, and also being a performance artist, I've been singing since I was four. And so combining the history, the creativity, as well as the revolution. One of my favorite books is the autobiography of Assata Shakur. So I've learned all about very strong Black women ever since I was young. And that has always resonated with me, and I've carried it with me, as well as my lived experiences, my community engagement through my family, particularly my maternal grandmother, Ethel Mae Welch, who was one of my first non-religious influences in my life, and being able to incorporate. And as we talk about hospitality and humanism, I come from the hospitality industry. I've learned how to engage people, and it wasn't easy to do. Being able to just talk to people and not talk at them, and being able to express my Blackness as well as my understanding of world history that goes beyond simply being Black, but also how we connect with each other on that, and being able to incorporate, being able to critically think with also the expression that comes from Black communities, particularly Black women, and those of us who do identify as LGBTQ+, not just myself, but some of my family members, as well as my daughter who does. So I realize that I represent for a lot of people, and that being a humanist is not simply what we say, it is always in what we do, how we live, how we engage people. And we don't always have to just say that we're humanists in order to show that we are. My work is rooted in direct action. It is rooted in how we live and how we love, and also how we engage, encourage people to be a better version of themselves. It doesn't necessarily have to be simply rooted in how we educate ourselves, but also how we show that peer support for each other, as well as hold each other accountable and just try to be better.
Wonderful, thank you all. And Mandisa, you set me up perfectly for the next question, which is the pivoting now to the hospitality part of our topic, and we'll be coming back to bring them all together, of course. What do you imagine, envision, hope for in a hospitable humanism? And what is the work the community needs to do, the humanist, atheist, free-thinking, secular community needs to do in order to bring that future about?
If you could, I'd like to start that one. Okay. Having come from the hospitality industry directly. Whether people realize it or not, the hospitality industry directly employs many people of color. Oftentimes who are unseen, oftentimes who are in positions that we take for granted. Those of us who organize, you know, who set things up, who make these things happen. And it's oftentimes thankless. We often deal with people who are dealing with other life issues. They feel like what they're doing is more important, so that the people that they're talking to are insignificant, and that we somehow deserve to be the brunt, or to bear the brunt of their frustration. And so we are seen as not being human. You know, we are seen as being things, people who are just there to service. And I've previously spoken on what our community can learn from the hospitality industry about what it means to better engage people, how to just simply be nicer to people, how we a common courtesy, saying hello, you know, saying thank you. These are things that shouldn't be hard to do. that we should not be in our own worlds, that we are not being considerate of the people around us. Even mm-hmm. if that this is a job that we're supposed to do, just simply say thank you and I appreciate you for it. That is how we humanize each other. And really coming down from this idea that we're too good to take on certain tasks. Like for, I remember in my capacity as the event services manager at the Centers for Disease Control's Conference Center, I was never too good to pick up and pull trash the same way my employees did. I was never too good to do any of those things that were considered menial or considered beneath me, because it wasn't beneath me, because it was teamwork. It was me helping my staff. It was me taking care of the clients and the customers. And we must realize that as a community, we are in service to each other, which means that at times we have to roll up our sleeves and get our hands dirty and do the things that we wouldn't necessarily do. And so rethinking of it in that framework is really, really going to be important. And seeing those people, seeing us, as though, and not just simply the recognizing who are in those positions, and they may not necessarily have the same academic credentials as other people, but they are just as important, if not more so, because they are doing things that you may not necessarily either feel are important or even want to do. So putting yourselves in our shoes is going to make a huge difference.
Yeah, thank you for that, Mandisa. It reminds me of a book that I recently read where an individual was questioning why she decided to have lunch every day at the same spot with those people who were unhoused. And she thought she was giving them dignity by sitting down and having a conversation with them and giving them food. And so she thought like, oh, I'm doing a good thing. I'm giving them their dignity back. And then she realized after years of reflection, after doing the same thing for 7 years, she was like, you know, I can't give anybody their dignity. All I can do is see them in their dignity, but it's not mine to give. I don't hold that power. And so when I hear you speak, Mandisa, you're talking about, you know, leveling the playing field so everybody knows that we're all equal. We all got jobs. We all have things to do. We all got families. And it is nobody's responsibility to try to over-engage in ways that make people feel uncomfortable, because that happens too, where people try to over-engage so they can say they did their good deed for the day. We're talking about true engagement, just seeing people, meeting them where they're at, just like people meet you where you're at every day. And the fact is that we make choices to do that. We make choices to see people. We make choices to understand that, as you said, Mandisa, like, people have whole other lives outside of doing the one thing that you see them do, and honoring that. Honoring the fact that they are coming from different perspectives, different places. But also, as you mentioned earlier, Mandisa, being that symbol of what it means to be a humanist without even saying it. So thinking, how can I engage? How can I enact my own humanism with everybody that I meet, with every person that I meet, no matter what they do that differs from me? And I think that is so important. And I think it's also important to remind yourself when you are encountering people in hospitality, when you are encountering anyone, in fact, that, I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought. I think I was trying to say that it's important to remind yourself when you're coming to the plate that this is vital for who we are as a community of people surviving this world, because of the very things that are happening in this world. There's so many examples that can show us that the world is going to hell. It's fire and brimstone and all those things. But it really, and it sounds cliche, but it really takes just that touch of kindness to remind people why we're still here and why we should still be engaging and why it's okay to let go and just be present with someone.
I agree with everything these beautiful people are saying. And I guess I especially agree with the idea that it is an action. And I guess an example, I'm like working with the Susquehanna Valley Ethical Society. And I think with what I noticed in that community was that it's how important it is to like give people a space to share themselves. 'Cause I was welcomed into that community through sharing. I needed an outlet to like, or I wanted an outlet to like share poetry, and they welcomed me to share poetry, and then it became like a community. And so I think it's very important, like they were saying, to be able to, I don't remember which one of you said it, but being able to see people as more than just what you see them do, and welcoming them, the totality of them, and allowing the space for them to bring the totality of them. And I think of it often as like people are kind of like a reflection in a mirror to yourself. And so kind of like what you see in another person is always in some way a reflection of how you view yourself, whether that is viewing someone kind of lower, and so you put on this false high sense of self so that you can put someone lower, but really you probably see yourself on that lower. But it's just like this mirror is constantly happening, and so it's very important to like expand your own sense of self so that you're able to see many different reflections. Also, I think one thing that I've kind of been like processing is Black ancestral process theology, and it came from this idea of like sitting in theology school and noticing a lot of like white nihilism, and it's very easy, white Christian nihilism and white atheist nihilism. And I think especially from my experience, like it's very easy to slip into nihilism when it comes to being like atheist and not religious too. I'm not gonna say, you know, again, there was like white Christian nihilism, but I think it's one thing that has I think again back to like the ancestry, like knowing the story of like how we are so connected to the connections from past and present and future and now, it really, like, one thing I've been reflecting on is that I am an ancestor right now, and what I do matters. And so if you reflect on your parents, your grandparents, all the people that made you now, and what they did in community and how they interacted with people, then it really like positions you in a space where like the actions that you do are going to definitely absolutely influence some like future generation. So I think for me, like thinking about the non-linearity of time and being an ancestor now and being Black has kind of shifted me to a point where I kind of slipped into it for a moment, but you cannot do nihilism because there is a community around you, and because this actually does matter. And nihilism has this idea of thinking like it doesn't matter. Nothing matters because we're just floating on a rock in space or anything like that. And so I think just reflecting on like your own place in space and time and what you can offer to people and how you are able to expand yourself beyond yourself and contract back in to do that inner work is like very important in spaces and in community. And so I think being like hospitable is being able to do that outward inward relationship constantly And I think especially a lot of people on like the more privileged end of sides of spectrums can really like use a lot of internalizing more. I think a lot of like Black people and women and femmes do a lot of internalization, and men or like white people do a lot of externalization. So it's really important to like always have that balance to, and of course on the other end, Black people probably need to externalize more. It's not always us and like vice versa. But yeah, I think that balance is always a good way to be in community and in hospitable ways.
I just want to add something really quickly because what Olivia just said made me think about this, like how hospitality is also a practice. Like it's not something that is necessarily innate for all of us, and that is something that we have to practice until it becomes a part of your embodiment, right? And so in that practice, you have to allow yourself to be uncomfortable. And what I feel like Olivia was speaking to was the fact that we've had ancestors and we have lived in uncomfortability for the majority of our lives in so many different spaces, especially white spaces. And so think of hospitality as a chance for you to practice that uncomfortability, practice sitting in it and maybe not knowing, but just being present and observing. If you don't know what to do, observe. You know?
Absolutely. Oh. Absolutely. It takes listening and learning as well. And it is a skill. It is a skill to be able to put that into practice. Some of us have had more experience and more, you know, we've done it longer than others. And that doesn't necessarily mean that, again, that we are absolutely better, but it gives us the opportunity to teach and be able to guide those around us who may be new to this. Because I had to come to a space where I realized that there are some things that some people just aren't aware of and that they may not know. And it is okay to say you didn't know, but what's not okay is to continue to not know. Or once you learn better, it is not okay for you not to put that into practice. So how we continue to navigate that, it's a constant process for us, but I think we really can help each other. And just simply in a, not necessarily in just this way, like I said before, talking at each other, but just, you know, how we just talk like, hey girl, you know, like, hey, this is how we do for many of us in our spaces. It can be, it doesn't have to stay uncomfortable. And also, like Olivia and storäe said, I feel like I am more connected to my ancestors as an atheist and humanist, because I am able to better understand the pain and the joys that they went through. Can better understand that even if something was done a certain way before, it may or may not necessarily be a good thing to do now, but also how we can take some of those lessons and move them into the future.
Yeah, it's beautiful. Thank you all for like really connecting those pieces. And I suspect that everyone in the audience for this conversation is quite familiar with the phrase, I think, therefore I am. And you know, I feel like the humanism that can exist into the future. So not just the humanism of the future, but the humanism of now, if we want it to exist into the future, also has to include feeling, also has to include expressing, you know, also has to include bringing not just our brains to the work, but also our hearts, our bodies, all of ourselves. And so what I wanted to ask as we're getting, I think we'll probably have time for one more question after this, but I wanted to make sure that we got this part of the conversation in, is what practices could people undertake to expand their humanism? You know, what does it look like if you're not someone who considers themselves an artist, or if you're not someone who considers themselves a performer? What does it look like to learn, to feel into your body, to feel into your humanism? Storäe, you want to start us off with this one?
Sure. It's such an interesting question. I was just kind of quickly reflecting on my own journey in humanism, which started roughly about 10 years ago, where I was in theology school and was seminary, and realized that I was an artist for the first time. And I had been creating, you know, my whole life, but never claimed to be an artist, never thought that I was that type of creative. Definitely didn't think I was a performer. Definitely didn't think, you know, I was able to do any of those things. And so I feel as if art lives in many different mediums. You know, I think we're always taught that, you know, you just do one thing really well, and that's the one thing that you're able to do. And I just believe that there's so many access points to embody, to create. And creation doesn't just have to happen on your own. Creation can happen in community. And it's one of the ways that I get to practice my humanism is when I create art and I invite others to that artistic ritual, to that artistic process, the workshop. I would invite those that are curious about how to embody to just try it, to join a group, to sit down and write and see what comes up for you. I think a lot of times we can hinder ourselves when we feel as if, you know, you have to have certain skills to do something. Who said that? Who said that? There's so many self-taught artists. There's so many self-taught anything. You know, cooking is such a beautiful, you know, art, culinary arts. The ability to share who you are through creating food together, to sharing a meal together. That's art as well. That's ritual as well. And those are very simple ways of challenging yourself to do something new, to get to know someone, to get to know yourself differently. You know, I don't think that there's any formula necessarily. I think it just takes being brave enough, being vulnerable enough to want to connect to yourself so that you can fully be yourself and connect with others. I think that's the foundation of it.
I guess I'll share that I think some practices that have helped me, and I'm a naturally very like quiet and observant person, but I think observation and really deepening a relationship with observation and listening, deep listening. And I think this could look like being in a space where you are not necessarily seeing yourself, and just being able to observe and like listen and grasp the atmosphere. I agree with Storäe. I think I'm also kind of in the space where I'm like discovering being an artist. And I think it came from a lot of journaling and automatic writing, just writing anything. I had more to say, but I completely forgot. So I'll leave it there.
Yeah, I know we're close to the end, but I would just add to all of the wonderful things that were being said was it will take, for me, it took forgetting unpacking any trauma that I experienced and really working to heal and overcome from that, and recognizing what I could bring to the table, as well as be in community to not just learn from, but also work with others. And that does take listening, that does take time. It may take time, but recognizing what I may be good at and what others may be as well, and also how we can work together with that.
Well, come on, I was back here. I make a lot of noise. I'm a body person, so all this was moving and everything as y'all were talking. So I'm very embodied with my humanism. And Nicole was, you know, having to, you know, maybe take a few ducks. Oh my gosh. Well, we have some questions for y'all. The audience has been pulling in, and I want to get some questions out to y'all so that that you can answer. We'll try to keep them limited, but I just want to get this question out. That is Jackie Rasek asked the question, where is the line between teaching and tokenization? Where is the line between teaching and tokenization? And feel free, I'm going to ask that Leika also join in on these questions, because there's a reason why Leika had to be the moderator for this, because there's also a deep aspect of their work in this as well.
I guess I'll start. I think the difference is when you expect that there is only one either Black or other woman, person of color, to do all of that work. There is nothing wrong with us, teaching and also, educating and informing folks. However, when you think that there's only either one person's job or that there's only one person doing it, then that's when it becomes a problem. And it also becomes burdensome when you expect that that one person is supposed to do it at their own expense and to exhaust their labor. That's when it becomes a huge issue and this is from my experience in being in this movement. It really does become, you start burning people out when you start expecting that, those who may have means and resources, you're expecting those who are marginalized to take on that work to educate you, and you're not putting anything back into it. There must be reciprocity when it comes to this, when it comes to this work.
Yeah, absolutely. And I agree with so much with everything you just said. And I think it's about, for me, it's about community and relationship. I think about the way that I feel about my family, my chosen family, my closest friends, and how do I feel about what they need and what they want? And I hear so many people say, specifically, white people who were especially, who were really early in the beginning of learning about other viewpoints, I have Black friends. Oh, but do you really? Because if you're actually in relationship, and I've experienced this a lot in the humanist movement, asking someone to come give a lecture is important, but not if it doesn't continue past that lecture. And if you just say, come speak to us so we can say we had a Black speaker, okay, that you're not looking to learn, you're looking to check box. But if we're building a relationship, if we're building a community together, then we can start that mutual engagement, then we're really moving toward learning and teaching.
Mm-hmm. Let's go on to the next question. This is actually specifically towards storäe. Do you have any speculative fiction recommendations that connect you to humanism or resonate some humanist values?
Can you repeat the question,
please? Do you have any speculative fiction recommendations that resonate or connect you to humanism?
Alexis Pauling Gums, who Olivia brought up earlier, writes this beautiful experimental text called M Archives After the End of the World. And it's a beautiful text in that she is writing as if the world has already ended and we're reading the archives of those who have emerged and are no longer human. But their ancestors were, right? And so it's this insight into what is left after humans have moved into a new version of what it means to be human. Mm-hmm. And I love that text because it also speaks to what caused it in the world, how we stop seeing each other, and what we need in order to move forward in a world where darkness is beauty, where darkness is life. You know, it really is a text that talks about those who are unseen and why it's so important that we see them.
So we have about 1 minute left. Jay, do you want to ask one more question or?
Yeah, let's just do one more. This one I'm gonna shoot to Olivia. So the question has been, cultural humanism, have you heard of it? And what does it mean to you?
I have heard of it. I think it was from you. But I think going back to kind of like the first question we had, cultural humanism is focusing on, because when I was in theology school, it was like, how do I bring myself into this very religious space where I don't like the God word? I don't like to talk about all of that. And so what are we actually doing here? What are we actually talking about? And I think it brought me back to, you know, looking at the Bible as like a story of ancestry, and going towards ancestry and the different cultures that we existed and how they're all shifting and changing, and what that, and looking at that through a lens of the non-linearity of time and our, like I was saying, our place in it, our place in ancestry. And I think cultural humanism, again, like going towards Alexis Pauling Gum, she has a book called Dub, and it speaks about like, it's like poems from the voices of channeling ancestors, and sometimes those ancestors are whales, and sometimes those ancestors don't really have a color, but they have a culture, and so she's talking about things that they do to sustain themselves. And so it's very cultural, and I think it helps too, because especially with humanism being a very on the outside, a very like a white space, I think it's very important because you can ask the question of, I think it's very important, I think a lot of white people are scared to do this, and I think it's very important for white people to ask when they became white, why they are white, and what that means in relationship to who brought them here and where they're going. And so I think cultural humanism just allows us to like really ask those questions of like, just those questions that we don't want to ask, that we sometimes don't even think to ask, like what rules were set, why were they set, who set them, and how many, and maybe what are some stories that I can look at where people said, maybe like, F those rules, I'm going to do something different or new or innovative. And so I think cultural humanism is questioning culture, creating culture, and like sharing culture.
Well, thank you. I just want to give I hope you at home, wherever you are, if you're doing this from work, if you can just give them just a round of applause or whatever, or put some claps or snaps or whatever, however you do over here, we gonna do all this. Okay, and I'm just very excited. If you have not, look in your chat. Black Nonbelievers has posted about their event coming up and things. So please scroll through there, get some of that information, get connected. We got to get connected. This is a larger community than just this little space here. And Nicole, go ahead.
We also want to say Black Nonbelievers is one of the sponsors of the conference. So please go visit their booth. And I know there's also more information on the community boards about the specifically the upcoming event is the Women of Color Beyond Belief conference in, I believe, September. Yes, Mandisa? Yeah. Mm-hmm. So thank you so much to all of our panelists. And that was a really thoughtful and thought-provoking conversation. And thank you so much for being part of it and for joining us today.